Hello, everyone. Good morning to you. Good morning to you online and you here in person. We're together, wherever we are spiritual seekers, gathered and scattered, but united in community. So wherever you are this morning, whether you're here in this community living room, or you're in your living room at home, or you're at your kitchen table, or you're in your family room, or you're at your cottage and you're raising your second or third cup of coffee, thank you for choosing to take this time to be with us, to sing together, to pray together, to make music together, to reflect with one another. We're continuing our summer series exploring the practice of pilgrimage, and today we're going to talk about something that we all have experienced, the travail of travel. I can feel that it is authentic and fresh for me, having made a round trip journey yesterday to Calgary for a wedding, and having the journey elongated by 45 minutes to get from the Nisku turnoff to 41st Avenue at the end of a long day, thanks to construction and paving work that was happening. So we all know something about the travail of travel. Amid the journeys of our lives, the joy and the pain of living, we seek to open to the laughter and our tears, and amid it all, to find wisdom for our living. And we come together to recalibrate and reorient as we breathe into this time, letting go of all those things that tug at our hearts and our minds. And we try to take our place mindfully with the land that we call home. And we honor the first peoples of that land, those of us in the SSUC communities of Edmonton and Saskatoon acknowledge that we're partners in Treaty 6 territory, which is the traditional meeting ground and gathering place and traveling route of Cree and Soto, Blackfoot, Métis, Dene and Nakota Sioux peoples. As Indigenous and immigrants and refugees, together we are blessed with sacred land and healing water with which we seek to live with deep respect and with mutuality and equanimity with each other. In the beauty of these summer days, we acknowledge with gratitude the radiance of the sun and our dependence on its heat to warm the soil, to synthesize plant energy, to stimulate growth, and the abundance we're beginning to see once again that nourishes us all. And we acknowledge our dependence on light as we light our candle this day, and we hope you join us in lighting your candle at home. We do so with gratitude for all that lights our way, for all that makes our life possible, for the light we find in one another, the light of our ancestors, the light of the generation coming behind us, the light we find in beauty and courage, the light of wisdom that helps us make our way. So we take this time, we choose this time, we bring ourselves to this time with each other, that it can be a place and a time that refreshes us and renews us. This is the time we sing ourselves into community. Thank you.
This is the time, this is the place to refresh and renew mindful space. Others around who also have found our connection to life as a common ground. Much wisdom to share for the wisdom to share for the living of our lives, a place for receiving and offering care, a time set aside to share. It's
also a time that we set aside to strengthen our intentions for the ways that we seek to live in our lives, in our time, in our world. And so we pray with one another. We pause with each other to open ourselves to the wisdom of our senses, the wisdom of our stories, the wisdom of our tradition, and our inner wisdom. May we sense the sacredness in us, in each other, and in the wonder of our planet. May we be moved to shoulder one another's burdens, share each other's joys, and empower one another to live with love, respect, and compassion, with trust that we can help one another along the way. We work and pray that it may be so. I want to share a story with you. Last time we were together in this circle, we were talking about the part of pilgrimage that has to do with getting lost, and how getting lost is not just about getting lost in terms of directions. There's a lot of things we can lose in our lives. And this is a story about the loss of memory and the work of community in searching for a way to find that together, helping one another. So it's the story entitled Wilfred Gordon MacDonald Partridge. That's our lead character. It's written by Mem Fox and illustrated by Julie Vivas. There was once a small boy called Wilfred Gordon MacDonald Partridge. And what's more, he wasn't very old either. His house was next door to an old people's home, and he knew all the people who lived there. He liked Mrs. Jordan, who played the organ. He listened to Mr. Hosking, who told him scary stories. He played with Mr. Tippett, who was crazy about cricket. He ran errands for Miss Mitchell, who walked with a wooden stick. He admired Mr. Drysdale, who had a voice like a giant. But his favorite person of all was Miss Nancy Allison Delacourt Cooper. because she had four names just like he did. He called her Miss Nancy, and he told her all his secrets. One day, Wilfred Gordon heard his mother and father talking about Miss Nancy. "Poor old thing," said his mother. "Why is she a poor old thing?" asked Wilfred Gordon. "Because she's lost her memory," said his father. "It isn't surprising," said his mother. "After all, she is 96. "What's a memory?" asked Wilfred Gordon. He was always asking questions. "It's something you remember," said his father. But Wilfred Gordon wanted to know more, so he called on Mrs. Jordan, who played the organ. "What's a memory?" he asked. "Something warm, my child. Something warm." And he called on Mr. Hoskins, who told him scary stories. "What's a memory?" "Something from long ago, me lad. Something from long ago." And he called on Mr. Tippett, who was crazy about cricket. "What's a memory?" he asked. "Something that makes you cry, my boy. Something that makes you cry." He called on Miss Mitchell, who walks with a wooden stick. "What's a memory?" he asked. "Something that makes you laugh, my darling. Something that makes you laugh." He called on Mr. Drysdale, who had a voice like a giant. "What's a memory?" "Something as precious as gold, young man. Something as precious as gold." So, Wilfred Gordon went home again to look for memories for Miss Nancy, because she had lost her own. He looked for the shoebox of shells he'd found long ago last summer, and he put them gently in a basket. He found the puppet on strings, which always makes everyone laugh. And he put that in a basket too. And he remembered with sadness the medal which his grandfather had given him, and he placed it gently next to the shells. And then he found his football, which was as precious as gold. And last of all, on his way to Miss Nancy's, he went to the hen house and he took a fresh, warm egg from under the hen. Then Wilfred Gordon called on Miss Nancy, and he gave her each thing, one by one. "What a dear, strange child to bring me all these wonderful things," thought Miss Nancy. And then she started to remember. She held the warm egg and she told Wilfred Gordon about the tiny speckled blue eggs that she'd once found in a bird's nest in her aunt's garden. And she put her ear to the shell and she remembered going to the beach by tram long ago and how hot she felt in those button-up boots. She touched the metal and she talked sadly of the big brother she had loved who'd gone to war and never returned. And she smiled at the puppet on strings and remembered the one that she'd shown to her sister and how she laughed with a mouthful of porridge. She bounced the football to Wilfred Gordon and remembered the day she had met him and all the secrets they had told. And the two of them smiled and smiled because Miss Nancy's memory had been found again by a small boy who wasn't very old.
So I'm going to share a story this morning by Virginia Sauvay called Getting Lost. In 1978, a group of Chilean students organized a month-long journey for me to Chile, where I stayed with six different families while I was there. The southernmost family I was to meet in Temuco. After a long bus ride there, I took a taxi to the address I'd been given and asked the driver to wait to ensure they were home. They weren't. A neighbor came and said they had left for their summer home on the reserve. They had no idea where that was. I asked the driver to take me to a hotel, and he tried four. All said the same thing. The city was full for a festival. They told me I would find no place to stay. It was now 10:30 at night, and I'm remembering Mary's predicament, lost in a strange city where I spoke very little of the language. I asked the driver if he could find a church with a house on the property. Half an hour later, he waited as I walked up to a house with no lights on and knocked loudly on the door with a prayer in my heart. A woman in her nightdress opened the door, and I began in halting Spanish to tell her my story and to ask for shelter. To my amazement, she replied in perfect English, the first English speaker I'd met in over 2 weeks. My relief was bubbling over. She told me to pay the driver and come in. Then the real miracle began. She asked me questions about the family I was supposed to stay with. Finally asking their name, I told her, wondering why. She started to laugh and said that he was her husband's cousin and they would be happy to take me out to the reserve where they lived and pick me up 9 days later, as there was no other way to get there. By now, her sleepy husband had joined us. It was midnight, and he sleepily agreed to the plan. I could hardly believe my good fortune. In a city of several hundred thousand people, my faith and a patient taxi driver had led me to probably the only person who could have taken me where I needed to go. The next day, we drove about 4 hours south to the Mapuche Reserve, where the large family welcomed me into their tiny home. They had not received their son's last letter, and they thought I was not coming. They had no telephone. The men stayed up all night roasting a lamb on a spit outside to welcome me. My adventures there had begun.
Thank you.
few years ago, I went to Nepal as a volunteer and worked in a center called Shanti Leprosy Clinic and Rehab Center in Kathmandu, Nepal. Here is an assembly in the center for the residents to watch a performance event. I'm an artist, so one of the activities I did was to paint the portrait of the residents. I learned the power of connecting with others in silence through art and creativity. Kenty was a young lady with Down syndrome. She was abandoned by her parents at birth and was then adopted into the center. She had the most beautiful smile. I set her in front of me and started to paint her portrait. And tears came down her eyes and I asked her, "Kenty, are you okay?" And more tears rolled down her rosy cheeks. Could the attention I gave her was able to evoke in her a deep sense of love and acceptance. This interesting-looking woman often stayed around the center at mealtimes to get her portion of food. She is of short stature, with many colorful bangles around her wrist. I set her in front of me and started to paint her portrait. As you can see, she looked very intently at my drawing. As soon as I finished my work, I gave her a piece of paper, brush and paint, and with that, she started to paint her own picture. Would she have been a painter before? Would her creative spirit was awakened momentarily by the attention I had just given to her? I continue my connections with the residents through art. I painted more portraits. Children painted and created many art projects. This journey made me a better human being with an increased sense of love and compassion towards others. Here is a photo of myself with two other volunteers from Germany. So this is my journey in Nepal.
Here's a little evidence that journeys change us. The slide you're looking at was what I thought we would read on Tuesday. Instead, I invite us to hear a poem by Kim Stafford entitled "Citizen of Dark Times." Agenda in a time of fear. Be not afraid. When things go wrong, do right. Set out by the half-light of the seeker, for the well-lit problem begins to heal. Learn tropism toward the difficult. You have not arrived to explain, but to sing. Young idealism ripens into an ethical life. Prune back regret to let faith grow. When you hit rock bottom, dig farther down. Grief is the seed of singing. Shame the seed of song. Keep seeing what you're not saying. Plunder your reticence. Songbirds, guard a twig. Its only weapon? A song. We hear story after story this summer of travel disruptions. It's one of the repeating headlines. Lost baggage, canceled flights, delays, missed connections, long lines, staff shortages. And for some, this is merely the inconvenience in privilege. In our first world travels. But for others, it's more consequential and more costly. And it's reminded all of us that there is travail in travel. They come from the same root word. There's always difficulty and a measure of danger in every journey. I don't know about you, but for me, there's always been a time in every journey that I regret having set out. And it might be in that moment of disorientation with language and custom, or the frustration of simply trying to navigate a menu in a language you don't recognize or an alphabet you don't know. Or deciphering directions to try to get where you want to go. Or trying to stay vigilant to all of those opportunities to be parted from our wallet and our bags. Or just needing the help of strangers. Or that moment of grunt in the impossibility that comes in every hike. Or as we pass an accident on the highway. And we have that sobering realization of how quickly and how easily lives are forever changed or ended. There's always those moments when we know the vulnerability in every journey and when the hassle of travel feels like more trouble than it's worth. And that moment when the work of making our way has lost the shine of challenge and has become this utter frustration or just discouragingly difficult. That familiar kind of moment I recognize in this well-worn parable from the first century of a journey and its fellow travelers. It's a story we all know well. This is the way Eugene Peterson in The Message tells this well-worn story. Just then, a religious scholar turned up and asked a question to test Jesus. He said, "Teacher, what do I need to do to get eternal life?" And Jesus answered, "Well, what's written in the law? How do you interpret it?" And he said that you should love the source of life with all your passion and prayer and muscle and intelligence, and that you should love your neighbor as well as you love yourself. "Good answer," Jesus said. "Do that, and you'll live." Looking for a loophole, he said, "And just how would you define neighbor?" And Jesus answered by telling him a story. There was once a man traveling from Jerusalem to Jericho. On the way, he was attacked by robbers. They took his clothes, they beat him up, they went off, leaving him half dead. Luckily, a priest was on his way down the same road, but when he saw him, he angled across to the other side. Then a Levite, religious leader, showed up. He also avoided the injured man. A Samaritan traveling the road came on him. When he saw the man's condition, his heart went out to him. He gave him first aid, disinfecting and bandaging his wounds. Then he lifted him on his donkey, took him to an inn, and made him comfortable. In the morning, he took out money and gave it to the innkeeper, and he said, "Take good care of him. If it costs any more, put it on my bill, and I'll pay you on my way back." "What do you think?" Jesus said. "Which of the three became a neighbor to the man attacked by robbers?" And the religious scholar responded, "I guess the one who treated him kindly." Jesus said, "Go and do the same." Like every good parable, this is a story that never happened, and a story that's always happening. Those hearing that story in the first century would know that this story is set on a notoriously dangerous road. Travelers are vulnerable to the elements, vulnerable to exploitation on this dusty descent that drops 1,000 feet over 16 miles through the Judean desert. Even today, guidebooks and locals will warn hikers about the dangers of walking the wadi that descends from Jerusalem to Jericho without the protection of a guide or going in a group or preparing adequately. And it's still a place that exposes you to crime and to the risks of dehydration or injury in a wilderness terrain. It's a story that does confront us with the dangers of the world we live in, and the danger we sometimes pose to one another. And it confronts us with the challenges and the choices of our human experience. It confronts us with seeing that there are some things over which we have no control, and there are choices to be made by some in the midst of cruelty and chaos. You'll notice that we don't have this story because someone wanted to know how to make the world a better place. We don't have this story because someone wanted to know how to help other people. The writer who gave us this most famous story that Jesus was said to have told gives us this story in answer to a very different question, a very individualistic, self-serving, somewhat pious question. Because the question isn't, what can I do to make the world a better place? How can I make a difference? How do I make the world safer for others? It was self-interest that gave us the story. What do I do to secure my significance, an enduring life? This is a guy who's concerned about racking up points in his favor. This isn't a story prompted by an interest in the common good, or as Adrian Rich would call it, public happiness. It's driven by self-interest. What do I need to do to exceed my expiry date? How do I beat my best before date? How do I ensure I've lived a significant life? In typical fashion of Jesus, in the Jesus tradition, the unconventional rabbi tells a story with a lot of sharp edges and painful mirrors. A story that the writer who gives it to us has to wrap an easy moral on it. But it remains a story with uneasy meanings. A story about how we walk a dangerous road, how we live in a dangerous world. And our attention's always captured by the unexpected hero, the Samaritan, the foreigner who did what the locals failed to do. And we critique the local temple leaders for their apathy and their piety and their indifference and their fear or whatever it was that kept them from doing a damn thing. But it's really the first traveler we meet in the story who alerts us to the travail of traveling. The first traveler we meet becomes a victim on this road. And we know nothing of his identity. We know nothing about the circumstances that placed him on the road. All we know is that he was attacked and injured while he was walking on this road, and that he desperately needs help. And like we've often experienced in our journeys, our help so often comes from where we've least expected it, or maybe even where we would have been reluctant to receive it, from someone we would have been encultured to disrespect or disagree with or distrust, from one who was a minority living in Samaria, a region that injured victim likely avoided his whole life. He was helped by the one that racial profiling would have presumed to have been the perpetrator, not the first responder. As we tell time now, in the last summer before COVID, that is, in the summer of 2019, Don and I were traveling in Germany and Russia and Mongolia and China. And I'm not sure that there was a day that went by that we weren't helped by a stranger. Whether it was someone trying to make an effort to communicate across the language barriers, or someone going out of their way to help us find ours, or a stranger who just sensed that we needed some help and took the initiative to ask if they could help us. And I have a particular memory of boarding a local bus on the outskirts of Irkutsk after we had returned from Lake Baikal. And we'd come back by boat and weren't quite sure how we would make our way from the port to our hotel And we saw two women who had been traveling on the boat, and they looked like they knew where they were going, and we followed them. And we followed them to a bus stop. And we followed them onto the bus. And we really had no idea where that bus was going, but we sort of hoped it was going towards the center of the city. And we only hoped that as we were going, we would see something we recognized, and we'd get off. But as we got out our map and we tried to spot something familiar in an alphabet we couldn't read, a couple of young men who were seated behind us in the bus pulled out their phones, got on Google Translate, handed their phone up to us and said, "Where do you need to go?" It would have been easy if we could have said where it was we needed to go, but we were going to a landmark that we were trying to describe, where we knew we could find our way back to our hotel. And it wasn't long before all the Russians who were seated around us were collectively working together trying to figure out where it was we needed to get to. And I will always remember how we were helped and we didn't even ask for it. And we were helped by a stranger who took the initiative with no common language, from a completely different generation, and then with the input of all the others seated around us, looking on their phones, looking at our map, trying to place where it was we were trying to get to. They all drew on that collective, and they got us off the bus at a stop where we could find our way back to our hotel. I know the old song is, you know, we get by with a little help from our friends. But really, without the help of strangers, our stories would all end very differently. And this was just one small example where we made our way with the help of strangers whose names and stories we'll never know, but who helped ease our journey. We don't all experience that same extreme of threat or injury or theft or loss in our travels that famous parable gives us. But in so many large and small ways, the travail of travel is always eased by the kindness of strangers. Sometimes it's costly, inconvenient kindness, like the Samaritan, or like the family who helped Virginia. And other times, it's someone going a little out of their way a few blocks and trying to point us in the right direction and get us back on track. The stories we get from the Jesus tradition are not nice little stories with an obvious moral. They're never tidy. They're always edgy and prickly, and we can cut ourselves on every corner. Because it's never just about two bad guys who didn't help and a bunch of thugs who did what they did and a good guy who did the right thing. It's not just about those who do bad things and those who don't do a thing and someone who does a good thing. It's a story about many radical things like receiving the aid that comes from your enemy or saving the life of someone you would ordinarily fear or someone who has done you harm. Or receiving goodness and exceptional kindness where we don't expect to find it. Perhaps even where we would be too cynical or too skeptical to accept it in ordinary circumstances. It's about times like these and people like us who can sometimes find it hard to see deep beauty in great ugliness. To focus on the unspeakable kindnesses in the midst of unthinkable cruelty. To celebrate where compassion supersedes callousness. To recognize that there are those who go high in response to those who go low. To prove that our highest humanity can be expressed in the worst of circumstances, and that every journey opens us to being humbled by the generosity of complete strangers who get nothing out of helping us. This is a once upon a time story we live every day, a story that invites us to be surprised by goodness, to headline those who help more than those who harm. And as the poet says, to inspire us when things go wrong, do right. Plunder our reticence. And as Mr. Rogers would say, look for the helpers. They're everywhere. We are everywhere. Thank you. want to share an invitation, particularly with those of you who are joining us online, an opportunity to have some conversation with one another on Zoom immediately following our gathering here at about 11:15 or so. You'll find the link on our website. An opportunity to explore with each other some of your experiences of the travail of travel or other themes that were evoked for you in this morning's gathering. And for those of us here in this space, an opportunity for us to share those stories with one another as we make our way from this circle into our day. And an opportunity for others to participate in the offerings that we have received last week from Curtis Tufts and this week from Virginia Sove and from Amy Lowen, to share of your own experiences of pilgrimage and journey with us. And it might be a pilgrimage that you made through your eyes in an experience of reading that was life-changing for you, or a travel experience like ones we've been sharing. It might be an opportunity to reflect on experiences of being lost, as we spoke about last week, or experiences of finding help in unexpected places, as we talked about this week. Wherever it sparks for you, you might share something of your experience of pilgrimage with us, either in an email to me or in a video that you share with me. Everything we do, everything that we make possible as a community depends on us and each of us doing what we can to support our work together. For some, it's offering time, and this community most generously offers time and talent. And for others, it's a capacity to support us financially, and we so appreciate the gifts that you offer and the ways that you support us by purchasing grocery cards and all the ways that you contribute. So we thank you for that, and a reminder on the slide that there are many ways to do that. We ask ourselves a question that arises for us as we think about the journeys we make through each day. How then shall we live? And that's a question we answer, not with a creed, not with a statement of faith, not with a cliche, not with our words. It's a question we answer with the way we bring our light to each moment in this week. When things go wrong, may we do right. In this week, when we see the opportunity to render help, may we be among those who offer our help. And in this week, when we need help, may we be those gracious to receive it from wherever it comes.